Chair, in relation to the minutes of the calling, the previous minutes, there was a request by your group that this committee request officers develop a full report which considers the impact on small businesses, traffic and wider community to enable councillors to fully scrutinise all aspects of the effect which occur in increasing the implementation of the parking charges. Given the calling, the presentation that was given by all those businesses, don't you think it would be wise that this committee does actually receive that report now and see if there's any benefits it can get through on this report?
Okay.
Thanks,
Jake. I'll just ask David Armstrong, did you get the gist of that thing?
Yes, I think so, yeah.
You know, when we asked the recommendation was that we could be done with that. Can you comment any further on that?
Yeah, we did, so I took that away from the meeting. We did some internal research on it, I did some research on it. There isn't a great deal of evidence out there directly showing the links between parking charges and effects on businesses. There's a very recently done by the Welsh Assembly, which looks at planning and the number of time towns, but doesn't actually draw any conclusions. And there's quite a bit of work done by Leeds University on the specialist traffic unit. But again, the conclusions were inconclusive. Indeed, in some of the research, it talks about having the parking charge increase the turnover of parking spaces. And that if, apparently, I didn't know this, but if we as motorists in our heads think there's a 1 in 6 chance of getting a space, more inclined to go to the place. So there is some research out there, it's very limited. I fed that back into the council. Clearly the council's planning team can't undertake that sort of research. They run the planning contract. What I need to do now is establish where in the council, if anywhere, we have the resource to do the full report.
Chair, I
would
love to put comments on the officer's mind, but if you look into the Scotland, what happened in Scotland, you'll find there's quite a lot of the car parks here, right, so not made anymore, that's going to be reversed. But it's other information on that.
Just before I bring you in, Jack, I'm going to bring you in. What we can do, Dave, is when we sit down to do the work programme,
okay.
We can look at it further then, if that's okay with you.
Yeah, certainly.
Okay, if you do that, Jack.
Just on that subject, we already have evidence in my ward that motorists are not parking in the car park at this country park, but parking outside on the road, even in advance of the parking charges being imposed, such is the fear.
Okay, so we're checking out of that anecdotal evidence.
Yes.
Yes. No.
Through you, Chair, can I just remind you of the work being made regarding the car park and traffic order? So it wouldn't be the fact that we are asking for the reversal of that decision.
No.
I think that must be quite clearly put for that. It's not for the sake of that fact. It's been dealt with in the fire order and a number of other people's decisions have been made by traffic order.
To be fair, Ron, on the members, they were just raising points from the minutes in the last meeting, that's all. No suggestion of that. Thank you. Before we start the meeting proper, I'd like to ask David Armstrong to give us a further update on the new ferry situation. And then when David's finished, if any members want to ask any questions, please feel free to do so. Thanks,
Chair. I think everybody knows this was a very sudden, unexpected, and very serious incident on Saturday night. It's resulted in a number of people becoming homeless,
combined effort this, and it's really brought into the good light the work of all the emergency services, along with the council, all working together. And this bodes really well for the future, I think. But what we need as members, I would suggest, is we need to know as quickly as we can what toiletries we can help with by donating, where we drop them. Do I drop stuff at the Life Church over the weekend? But I think that's only a temporary thing. What I'd like, I'll appeal to the officers to let us know as soon as possible what people are desperate for, and even clothing, because there are people who are, who came out of their properties with literally nothing. So they might need clothing, toilet, and all the other things. So if the officials can let us know, and a place where we can drop it all off. So I'd make that.
But they are actually collecting village
hall. Yeah, but what I'd like, Irene, is that we know a place, you know, most members won't know where the village hall is. So what I'd like is for the officers and toiletries that are needed, specifics, you know, whether it's soap, toothpaste or whatever else, and if there's any clothing that's needed, where we can talk about.
Thanks. We'll do that. Just to finish off, what we're going to do, clearly, once the police release the call, we'll bring it in, our structural engineer and the building control team have been there all week. They will assess each building, and clearly, I think in most cases, it's been possible for people to be escorted back into their property, hopefully to get possessions out. That won't be possible in a small number of properties because of the state of the building. That's what they've been saying to us this week, isn't it? But they're not particularly the shops, the shops, offices, where the butchers and the Chinese are. They those buildings are quite unstable. But where we can, once we're allowed to, we will help people to get things from their properties, and then their properties will be secured. The police are currently maintaining the colony, so they'll be secured. Our contractors on site currently working with them. Again, once they give the okay, he will clear the debris from the roads and begin to clear the site. So that's the plan.
Recently from Cheshire West. She saw the ground. grass was greener.
Services that we offer out to our schools. We've done that for many years, but we're still continuing to offer services out to our schools. across a range of things, including payroll, HR, IT, risk insurance. Even this, for the first time this year, we're offering out a library service as a commercial aspect, even though our schools are currently paying for it. And interestingly, we've just analysed some of the figures for the buyback for 17-18 around school trade services, and it looks like schools are still wishing to buy services generally back from the council, even though we know schools are facing some budgetary pressures as well. We've got an Anglican cemetery crematorium, and again, a range of services that are offered there. But again, interesting to see that the cemeteries and crematorium are actually generating quite a large amount of income. And actually make a net council budget contribution in terms of what they do. They're a small amount, but they are at least covering their costs from the cemeteries and crematorium. And finally, again, members are probably aware of this, but the Forum Pavilion, where we were 200,000 visitors a year were coming to the Forum Pavilion, attracting international national performers, international national people coming to visit the Forum Pavilion. And again, generating quite a significant amount of annual income, and with a reducing amount of subsidy going into the Forum Pavilion. There are many other commercial activities that take place across the council I can talk about tonight, but these are four, I think, the ones that I highlight with you to show that we are already operating in a commercial way within the council. However, what we're finding, certainly the initial work, was a lot of this was taking place in pockets within the council. And what we did really have was a coordinated approach to our commercial activity across the whole of the council. So what we looked to do was to establish a commercial working group. This commercial working group worked up a cabinet report, which was agreed by cabinet on the 27th of June 2016, last year, which set out our vision for the commercial approach for the council. A few key words in there, again, members will be aware of this, but they resonate in some of the jobs and works and aspects of life that you have as well. One would be about being customer focused. Again, I think a key emphasis for any business or any occupation or any service really is about being customer focused. We're always looking for innovation and perhaps looking for those entrepreneurial approaches within the council to help to deliver high quality, particularly value for money services. We may not necessarily be the cheapest, but we want to make sure we offer the best value for money when it comes to services. And all of this, of course, is to support the Wirral plan. We've also agreed through Cabinet five key principles. The interesting one for me is the aim. Because again, if I was to ask colleagues within the room today, members within the room as well, define commercialism or define a commercial approach, I think we'd all have a slightly different take on it. So what the council is looking to do is to adopt, is you take a look at AIM, which talks about, for once I'm going to read out the slide, but hopefully you don't mind. This is our definition, we think, of commercialism. It's about maximising charging trading assets and investment opportunities to generate income surpluses and to reduce costs. That's what we're looking for, ultimately, around defining what we are about the commercial approach. So that was taken to Cabinet last June, and we've got an agreed vision and principles that allow officers, therefore, to further develop the commercial approach across the council. An interesting question is, where does the commercial approach sit within the council in terms of its current strategic, in terms of its alignment and working groups? So we looked at different options. The option we think we're favouring at the moment, we're looking for final agreements on this, is about the commercial approach, its strategic alignment, is around complementing, if you like, the main areas of the council. We've got some big areas that already generate enormous amounts of income within the council, lots of areas where we don't necessarily want to stifle what they're doing, so particularly around growth, assets, housing, transformation. But of course, we want to reference what they're doing. But there are many other aspects within the council that could benefit from a more formal commercial approach. And what we're talking about here is obviously a strategy in draft at the moment. We're looking at establishing a governance and commercial board. There's a question mark about where ADMs, that's alternative delivery models, so we've already got two-edged section evolutions, where how they informally report into the council. We can check we're getting the right source of commercial returns coming back from those ADMs. But again, providing support and challenge for services across the council as we become more commercial. So that's what we're looking towards for our strategic alignment. Linked to that, again, I won't go into too much detail on this particular slide, but what we haven't yet at this moment in time got is an agreed workflow. So if somebody's got a good idea, how do they go about getting it done? Where is the formal checks and balances to make sure it is actually a good idea? And we are managing the risks, both from a commercial point of view, but also a reputational point of view for the council as a whole. And what we are proposing here, there's a lot of work sitting behind this, is a workflow in terms of ensuring governance around commercial ideas is managed within the council. At the moment, there isn't anything formal in any great detail that I'm aware of across the council. Two things have come out for the commercial, what we're expecting from what was a project that we're now looking to move into business as usual. The main one, which we referred to earlier, we're looking for around about financial expectations of around £1 million per year surplus from the commercial approach for the next 4 years. So as I referred to earlier, at the moment the Cabinet report is stating it's around £650,000. We're not at £1 million. Therefore, working with colleagues across the council, we're looking to generate new ideas that can generate new income to help support the budget that the council has set. The second thing as well, the second main benefit we're looking for from this commercial approach is about developing the culture across the council, helping staff to become more commercial. And we're not just talking here about staff necessarily at the front line of our commercial organisations like floral, leisure, etc., but also back office support staff. You know, making sure that they become more commercially aware and more commercially how they approach working with colleagues within the council and just for services as well. Coming back to that vision and that being customer focused. So what have we done particularly around the commercial approach culture? There is an intranet support site that's been launched internally within the council. The first time we've got support materials there for colleagues across the council to help and support develop any commercial ideas they've got, but also current activity as well. We've got some e-learning modules that have been developed for staff and for other people within the council. We're now looking to develop training for managers and above, as our next phase of development, and looking at member engagement with this as well. And obviously a key part of this is reviewing practice across other local authorities and providers as well. So looking to the private sector to see what they do and other public sector organisations. So that's what we're looking to do to help to develop the commercial approach. Mentioning other local authorities, just want to take you through very briefly some research we've done around what other local authorities, these are just examples of what other local authorities are doing. Perhaps those were more up towards the end of the spectrum where we're hoping to get towards about being a more commercial council. So we'll start with Warrington Council, not very far away from this of course. Three things, in fact many things they're undertaking in terms of their commercial approach, but one thing that they've started with or that they have agreed to, they're investing in a new bank. And this bank has been set up. It's quite a big investment for the council. They're looking to invest £30 million over 3 years in setting up this bank, although 33% share. And the main focus for it is to help and support small businesses that are struggling to get finance from traditional financial lenders. So to help support, particularly in Warrington. Secondly, Cllr Farm. Not in Warrington, but down south, is an investment that Warrington have gone into with two other councils, and they've purchased bonds. And what they're looking for is a return on the investment they made in this Cllr Farm down south, and they're envisaging they're getting £500,000 of return on top of the investment they put in every year. And the final thing from Warrington, again, you may be aware of this, but they decided to help, basically what they've done to is they purchased a 25-year deal to help purchase a site up for the shop for Matalan in Warrington, and what they're expecting to get is nearly a £400,000 per year return on that investment every year from Matalan coming back. So that's Warrington. Moving on, Manchester City Council, they've gone down the route of setting up a joint venture for Matrix Homes to deliver 240 new homes for sale and rent, and they've set up the company themselves in partnership with the Greater Manchester Pension Fund and the Homes and Community Agency. Started works on the first site to begin this May. So already they're ahead in terms of getting their housing stock increased, but they're taking on that role themselves. They're not looking to outsource it, sell land off, they're actually doing it themselves through a company. So again, they can get the profits and benefits from that particular investment. Sorry about that. Now that's what I want to talk about is Nottingham City Council. Again, Nottingham is held up there as being one of the councils that are at the forefront of commercial development. One of the things they've done over the last sort of few years is about property investments. And apparently in the last 12 months, they committed to new investments of £44 million. About 60% of that was invested in Nottingham, but they are looking at investments outside of Nottingham that will give them generating a net revenue of nearly £2 million off that £44 million worth of investments around the property. tackling fuel poverty. This is about establishing an energy company and looking at the returns that can bring to the council. With all of this activity going across the council, what we're also aware of is there is limited support at the moment to help and develop commercial activity within the council itself. So we are looking to develop a commercial unit or commercial support within the council to help services become more commercial. And the final thing to mention is around investments. We're looking at limited investments from the council, but looking at to do this within the treasury management rules that we already have. But looking at two or three key ideas where we could get a significant return on the investments, but some additional ones that may not be there already. And that's it from me. Questions, comments, Simon?
Interesting presentation. Two questions. One is in relation to the training, which seems to be later than at the end, probably at the beginning, for managers and others, which was part of the process. And the other one is in relation to the initial part, where you said we've got four individual parts of the council. How are you going to bring them together and make them run as one unit? Breaking down silos.
Now a whole new ball game, if you put in a whole new ball game. time. Really strong pockets of good innovative ideas. Think about the pension funds we talked about before, they're brilliant at investment, and we are the, obviously the industry body, body for those, and do we do enough work with them in order to learn skills of them? So that helps us. We have the floor, we have leisure, have we learned the best from them? And they're part of that group that's driving forward for everybody else now about being commercial. Hence, it is critically important that this is seen as a whole council. That innovation, I think, comes in two strands. Again, Stuart touched on the staff, but in terms of best practice, you know, clearly on that line that we showed you in terms of work, old councils were, where we only received a government grant all those years ago, and maybe some council tax and some business rates. You know, people have moved along that now. We've had to charge over the years. We've had to bring the innovation in. Some other authorities are a bit further along that line than we are. We want to catch up with them, really. It's not to say we're not doing good things. We really are. But I think it's about some of that, the control that I think you're referring to, Chris, around, you know, just how we do that, how we engage with entrepreneurs, how we do that first locally in terms of what's happening, for example, with the pension fund. Secondly, you're right in terms of we have got the work and set up with the Chamber of Commerce, how we can work with that. Third element is, I think the part of that is about how we push back on some of the risk and what's our risk appetite as an organisation in terms of some of the inventive ideas that you've seen with some of the what would seem to be high risk aspects of what Warrington and others have done so where are we in that trajectory. And then finally, just in terms of touch on the energy company, you're quite right, Bruce, just in terms of its current status, it is absolutely that. It is an energy company that we're creating in order to ensure that we tackle fuel poverty. It doesn't mean to say that at some time in the future that might be such a good benefit that we can actually spread that out in terms of both across the city region, but also more importantly about how we can do that we could potentially get a dividend from. But the first tranche of it is about making sure we actually get the best value for customers first. Do you want to touch on staff? Sorry.
Can I just come back on the points? So, still don't feel like you completely gave me the answer I'm looking for about how you're looking for innovation, what you're doing, what you're actually doing. And I think my worry is well around risk with the council is, I hope that we're not just going to go down the route of just thinking we're wrong to doing something, but let's do that. It's all innovation and entrepreneurial spirit and coming up with creative ideas. It can't just be about copying some others. I'm not suggesting it's the same, but again, it's good to be to clarify.
Just a very small part of what we're doing around the innovation side of it.